Dave. It's a very nice weather, especially I was just last week in Chennai, and it's quite hot over there. And it's, I've been through three different weathers in 1 week. So it's nice to be here, and thank you all for making it early in the morning. And I hope you find something valuable to take away from here. Today I'm talking about code complexity and basically understanding. You know, I'm not going to dwell too much on the theory side of things, but like, you know, very quickly we'll try to jump into the practical aspects of it and, you know, how we are actually going to use it. And I'm quite comfortable, you know, whenever you have a question, you can either wait till the end or you can ask it right then and there. If it's going to come up, I'm just going to ask you, you know, like, yeah, it's going to come up, so maybe you can just wait for a while. So please feel free, if you have a question at any point of time, please stop me and ask. That's me, or you can see here, that's me. I'm an engineering manager at Accelerant. I contribute in various ways to the Drupal ecosystem. I'm quite proud to be contributing in code and non-code manner. And I'm quite fairly active on Twitter. Those who follow me on Twitter might know also. If you want to talk to me about this session or about anything at all, Twitter is the best place to reach me. I'm not a very great email person, you know, so Twitter is the best way. And I encourage you to, you know, DCP90, that's the hashtag here, right? You know, so if you want to tweet, you can always tag me. So let's talk about complexity. What's complexity? You know, like when we just say complexity, what does it mean to you? And I'd like to explore the topic of complexity through different words. You know, the words that we use, you know, when we talk about how complex certain something is, anything, you know, any system, any environment, any ecosystem, you know, what does it mean? One of the words that's sometimes used to describe, you know, like, you know, how complex a system is, you know, we just say that, oh, this is really simple, or this is really easy. Can I have a show of hands just to see how many people think that is the same? So, like, if you think simple and easy are the same things, can you just give me a show of hands? Simple and easy. Are they the same thing? Not a lot of people. So, I guess, you know, one of the slides is completely basically useless over here. So, that's fine. But yeah, you know, I agree with most of you here that simple is not necessarily easy. You know, what something can be simple, but it may be really, really hard to understand or to implement. It may be simple to understand, but hard to implement. And that's where we get lost, you know, when we write a piece of code, and more on that later, but, you know, I'll just touch upon it right now. When we write some piece of code, and this is nothing to do with complexity, by the way, but I'm just, like, taking one example related to functional programming here. You might be tempted to do something in for each, and someone will tell you, no, there is an array map, you know, use array map for this. And you would think, why? For each is easy, you know, it does the job. And someone else would say, you know, like, no, array map is the proper way to do this, is the pure way to do this, the functional aspect of it. And, like, you know, I'm not going to debate the merits of functional application, functional programming style over here, because that's out of scope. But yeah, very often, something, you know, when you look at a piece of code, if it was easy to write, it's very, very rare that it was simple to implement. Let's look at another pair of words, complex versus complicated. So now, how many of you think they are the same thing? Show of hands. Sure, okay. Would anyone want to explore, like, you know, what, you know, why do you think it's the same, complex or complicated? How are they the same thing? What does complex mean to you, and what does complicated mean to you? You're very welcome to speak up, but if not, let's, someone wants to talk about that. Okay, so complex sometimes can just refer to the number of pieces in a system. You know, today morning we saw that slide about interchangeable parts. You know, how the industry as a whole has evolved because we had interchangeable parts in the system. In anything that we build, now we have interchangeable parts. You know, like, why do we have, you know, like, so many varieties of phone? Because they are basically made of interchangeable parts. You know, you get a system, you know, a system chipset, you get a screen, you get a battery pack, and you put it together in different ways, and you have different variants of phone. That's how our industry thrives. And the number of players in a system like this relates to the complexity of the system. There is a correlation. Complication is more about how effectively they are playing with each other. I think, you know, like in the course of you know, the later slides, it might make more sense what I'm saying here. But essentially, complicated is like, you know, have you ever looked at a piece of code and, you know, you said that, oh, this is spaghetti code. If you have ever done that, intuitively you know that, okay, there is a property of this piece of code where it's touching a lot of things, and that's complication. But just because a method is dealing with really complex things, it's not necessarily complicated. For example, the entity manager in Drupal, you know, how the entity manager talks with the field manager and the what's that type system? The type data set system, the whole, how it talks to all of that, it's quite complex. But is it complicated? I'm not going to enter that debate right now again. And don't worry, we're not going to talk about that. You know, we're going to talk about in very, very simple terms about these notions of complexity. So, this is the slide, you know, which I said, you know, it will be completely useless now, since most of you agree with me that, you know, what is simple is not what is easy. But I really like this quote. Harry Potter fans here would know this is somewhere in Goblet 5, where, you know, Voldemort is back again. I'm not spoiling anything for anyone, right? So Voldemort is back, and, you know, Harry is telling Dumbledore that, okay, you know, everything is changing, and what do we do? And Dumbledore is basically making the plans for the order, you know, what I'm going to do. And basically says this, you know, very soon we'll have to choose between what is easy and what is right. And that always struck me, because these are not opposites. By any definition, these are not opposites, you know. You would say that, okay, between what is right and what is wrong, you know, that's like the more, like, you know, consumable statement, I would say, right? But the choice of word here is easy and what is right. It's almost as if easy is a placeholder for wrong, right? And that always struck me, you know, that whenever we think about something, oh, this is really easy to do that, and like now, I mean, of course, now, it's like, you know, in my mind there's always warning bells going on that, oh, it goes too easy, there must be something wrong with that. And by the way, it's not always the case. You know, you should never think that, okay, it was easy to get here in traffic, so it was all wrong. I'm from Bangalore, so it was easy for me to get here. So this is where I draw this distinction between simple and easy, right? You know, something may look very easy to implement, but it's only going to cause problems later on. So let's look at this from the views of what is right. And like, why should we bother about, you know, what is right? You know, we are just writing code, right? And as all industries go, code is relatively, the software industry is relatively transient. You know, you write a system today, you can throw it off tomorrow. Theoretically, that rarely ever happens, right? But like, okay, we're not even going to go into that discussion. But I will definitely talk about this, that any piece of code, you might write it once, but you might read it at least 10 times. Other people might read it 10 times. And even if you say, oh no, this is my own thing, you know, you in 2 weeks is some other person. You will not remember why you wrote this. So this is what I'm going to talk about, maintainability. In my view, we worry about complexity because we have to worry about maintainability. As software developers, it's our responsibility that whatever we do, you know, it's not just that we are making a system that works sometimes, you know, there are bugs always, but this software system has to be maintained by you or somebody else. And believe me, even in 2 weeks, I can't remember, you know, what I did yesterday. what work I did, you know, what meetings I attended yesterday, or what pieces of code I wrote yesterday. And context is a tricky thing. You know that state of flow you have when you're working on something very, very deep and you go into state of flow and someone just says, hey, can you help me with this? Oh, or hey, do you want a glass of water? Or do you want some coffee? And you lose the whole flow. So if you lose the context in 2 seconds that way, imagine in 2 weeks if you have to read the same piece of code, will you be able to understand it? Will you be able to maintain it? And that is why we worry about these things like complexity. So let's get back to code. You know, we talked about, like, you know, we had like kind of a philosophical discussion, so let's get back to the code. Three main things I want to talk about here. You know, one is code smell. Does anyone want to talk about what code smell means to you? Anyone? No one?
Analyze the code.
I'm sorry, what? Can you repeat?
Analyze the code.
Analyze the code.
Okay. This is the first time I'm hearing it, but smell is something that you, at the first time you see something, or
okay,
you hold something, you lose something, you smell something. So maybe a feel of how it makes you.
Okay, so you said, I'm saying this again so that it gets recorded. So you're saying that code smell is something like, you know, like how you smell other things. When you see something and you smell it and you get a feeling, that's what code smell is. Anyone else want to elaborate or say something related?
Certain patterns in the code.
Okay, certain patterns in the code.
Just observe.
Okay, just observe. Yeah.
It's like that you follow the coding standard and you again
sorry, what? Readability of the code, or like those aspects of code, like duplication, like you said, yeah, all of those things. Yes, you're very right. You know, the name smell, you know, like. And like, I was trying to find an emoji. I was very sure there was an emoji which kind of had like a frown, smelly face, you know, but I couldn't find it in time anyway. So yeah, that's the idea behind it. You know, you look at piece of code and you don't know why, but something about it strikes wrong to you. You know, like something smelly, that's what basically is. It could be duplication, it could be readability. And you just know it, you know, maybe you can't explain it in words, and hopefully you can once you look at it from the theoretical point of view. You know, like we're going to look at some measures a little later and some tools, so maybe later you can explain it. But you know, like, you know, why does experience matter in this industry, this age? Why does experience matter when, you know, we have technologies coming out every day? You know, there is a quote, and I love quotes, by the way, a little bit about me. There is a quote: in times of constant change, experience can be your worst enemy. Right. So why does experience matter today? Experience matters, in my opinion, it matters because it's not that, you know, there are new technologies, so you have to throw everything you've learned so far. Nobody does that, right? When there's a new technology today, we quickly learn it. And we apply whatever we learned before into that, right? There is a kind of continuation. That is why experience matters. And sometimes we can't explain why we think certain things. You can call it bias, or you can call it machine learning, but it's, you know, like that's the instinct we have, which leads to what we call code smell, colloquially, right? So that's one aspect of this, you know, and I know we're talking about maintainability, but like that's like one of the first entry points we have into this, that, oh, there's something funny about this piece of code, like, you know, let's look at this again. Especially doing peer review, you know, you're reviewing someone's code. Maybe we can do something different over here. Maybe we can do this differently. Okay, what's next? Peer review. Oh, there was a segue. So, peer review, let's again have a show of hands and like, tell me how many of you don't follow peer review at times or at all? Okay. Okay. At times, or like occasionally also, you know, like occasionally or at all. So basically, if you always have committed or merged peer-reviewed code, then you don't raise your hands.
Sometimes,
Okay. Alright, makes sense. Okay. Alright, so it's good to see, you know, like, okay, most of us, at least sometimes we follow the, like, you know, follow peer review practices. And again, that's important because of what I said earlier, Portsmouth, right? You know, how do you gain experience from other developers in your team, right? So this is another thing where you can catch mistakes in your code. Like, tools notwithstanding, but again, you know, not everything can be covered by tools. You know, tools are just dumb machines. You know, like, it's ultimately the engineers who are responsible for the code. And measuring complexity, again, we'll be talking more about this when we talk about tools. So basically, you know, like, with this we have kind of a holistic picture about, you know, how we get around the complexity problem in our code. Basically getting it to a reasonably maintainable state. I'm not saying going to say absolutely maintainable. I don't think that ideal state exists. So let's look at a few popular metrics. You know, when we talk about measuring complexity, let's talk about how do you measure something abstract as complexity. So I'm not going to talk about a lot of them. I'm going to show you some of them later, but like for now we'll just talk about this. Anyone familiar with this? It was a very popular comic, and you know, it's kind of like, I mean, whenever you talk about code quality, this slide has to be there. I think it's kind of like a rule. So that's the only reason I have it over here. Yeah, so like whenever you're reviewing code, how many WTFs per minute, that's the measure of how good your code is. Well, okay, so let's go to the serious things now. Okay, so cyclomatic complexity. Anyone already familiar with the term? Not a lot of people? Okay. Alright, so cyclomatic complexity, it's basically means the number of decision points you have in a function. And we'll look at an example. But you know, like your regular keywords like if, while, do, for, you know, like, you know, wherever there is a decision point, oh, will I enter this block or not? How many points in your function you have those, like, you know, you have that kind of code in your function? That's the cyclomatic complexity. And the general measure is around 1 to 4, like really small functions, you know, it should not be like more than 4. And should certainly not be about 10. You know, that's a good sign that if you have 10 decision points in your function, it's a good sign that you should start considering defactoring. So now this is one such factor, but let's look at another one quickly. N-path complexity. Anyone heard of this? Okay, so now N-path complexity, like the description over there says, the number of paths in a function. So because of those decision points, the function can take multiple paths, right? You know, like, so you have a function, and like we'll see that slide now. So you see this, it's actually a part of function, you know, it's not even the full function. So you have six if statements, and the function itself. So the cyclomatic complexity of this piece of code is 7. Assuming this is the only piece of code in the function. It's not, by the way. So, little tidbit, this function in whole was like, cyclomatic complexity was like, what, 20 or something. And N-path complexity was like a billion. So, let's relate that. So now, over here you see there are 6 decision points. And when the function executes, there are various combinations, you know, in which these if statements may be, like, when the execution would enter these if statements. So, like, the first condition we see over here, array key exists, meta types type, you know. So, if it does not exist, we enter this block of code. But if it exists, we don't. So, there are 2 paths over here. Now, this next one, you know, similarly, if array key exists for description, you know, we enter this piece of code or not. So, now, in these 2 blocks, we actually have 4 different paths. You know, like, you know, one path in which we enter none of them, in one we enter both of them, in one we enter only either of them. Right? So 4. Like, if you just consider these 2, the N path is already 4. But now it keeps getting added up. You know, so now in this if you add it, now the N path complexity is 8. And I'm not, like, I can't calculate, you know, how much it will be in 6, in maybe 64 or something. I don't know. But and this is quite a reasonable small example. Real world functions are quite complicated. I think when we were in this Drupal 8 migration, like years back, when Drupal 8 was actually being built, there was a function in Drupal 7, and like that became a good example, called Drupal HTTP request. Anyone remember that function?
Yes. Yes.
Right? And that had an nPath complexity of like, I don't know, billion or 20 billion, something like that. So what does that mean? When I say like 1 billion or 20 billion, what does that mean? I already said that nPath is like the number of paths in a function, right? So when you say that the nPath of a certain function is 20 billion, it means there are 20 billion possible execution paths in that function. So if you were writing tests, automated tests, or even if you were manually testing this piece of code, you would have to test this function completely, you would have to test it 20 billion times. Or you would have to write 20 billion automated tests to say that, okay, I'm completely, there is 100% coverage for that function. Of course, it's not practical to write tests like that. So that was like one of the first functions to disappear. There was even worse function in contraband. I think it was in date module, something called date rule something, right? I'm forgetting. And that had like, I mean, I can't even say that. It was like, the numbers went over three lines, something like that. There was one measure, you know, like Americans, they have very weird measures, you know, because they use anything except the metric system. So there was a weird measure that if you want to test that function, and if you start writing tests, you would need SD cards the size of Greenland. So, I mean, of course, it's practical. Nobody is going to write those kind of tests, which means it's never going to be tested, which means it's always going to break, right? Which means it's not maintainable. You know, that's our worry here. So let's go. Okay. So kind of see, cyclomatic complexity doesn't help us that much, but nPath is too difficult to use. You know, like billion. You know, like, you know, what do you mean by a billion? You know, we can't even process that number. Or like, you know, when I said that, like numbers over three lines. You know, you can't even process that number. How do you translate it into something that you can use to actually measure code? And there's another thing called CRAP. Sorry. Google also likes to hear. Okay, so just one formula. CC over here is cyclomatic complexity, and CO is test coverage. And I would like to point out this thing. So, so by the way, this metric, the ideal state is like around 10-ish, 10 to 15-ish. But 30 is like worse, you know, like, I mean, anything more than 30 is bad. So if you look at this formula, you know, bear with me, I know maths in a software conference is like weird, is it? How many of you like maths? Oh, okay, a lot of people, fine. So I'll talk more about this formula. Right, so if you consider this formula, you know, it's like this cyclomatic complexity plus this part, right? So let's forget this part, you know. So if cyclomatic complexity itself is 30, then your crap is already 30, you know, you're already worse off. So any amount of, so CO stands for test coverage, you know, how much test coverage is there on your on that function. So if your CC is already 30, the function is already crap. So like first thing is, what this measure says is like, try to reduce the cyclomatic complexity. And we are fine, because, you know, we anyway say that, you know, 10 is already high enough cyclomatic complexity for a function. On a side note, anyone heard of single responsibility principle? SRP? Few people? Yes. Basically, it says that a class, well, in SRP, like the word is class. So a class should only do one thing, not many things. You know, it's like, you know, if it says it's like, you know, like a mail sender, it should only be sending mails. It should not be writing to UI, for example, things like that. So think of, you know, the same principle when you apply to the functions in the same vein. You know, like if your function is doing too much, that's when there is a chance of cyclomatic complexity increasing. So try to break up your functions. Don't try to do a lot in your functions, right? So now, again, now let's look at this second part. So if you look at this, the test coverage, you know, usually it's measured in percentage. Right, we'll normalize it over here. So like suppose if you have 50% test coverage, so COE is 0.5 in that case. With me so far?
Yeah.
right? You know, you really need strong coffee for match like this. So as CEO, if you look at it, you know, if the test coverage is 100%, you know, which is not really possible, but let's say it was 100%. Okay, so 1 minus 1 is 0, and basically this whole part disappears, right? So in that case, CRAP is just the cyclomatic complexity, right? So if your function's cyclomatic complexity was 10, and you have 100% test coverage on that, your CRAP is 10. Okay, but now let's look at the other side of things. Okay, we're fine. So if there is no coverage at all, 0. So this is like 1 and CC squared. So like suppose, same example, CC is 10 and there's no coverage, you basically have 100 into 1 plus 10, so like your CRAP is suddenly 110. So cyclomatic complexity 10, which is still fine, I guess, but because there's no test coverage, it suddenly comes to 110. So this one measure, it kind of gives like a kind of a balance, you know, that, okay, you know, even if your cyclomatic complexity is too high, but if you have enough coverage, you're fine. Or if your cyclomatic complexity is not too high, like, you know, very simple function, like, you know, like, let's say 3, CC of 3. In that case, it will be 3 plus 9. 9 in that case. Suppose there's no coverage. So 3 plus 9 is 12, which is okay, not great, but not bad also, you know. So like, this, there is this measure which kind of balances out there. Any questions so far before we move on? Okay. So let's go in a little different direction for a while and talk about static analysis. Can anyone tell me what is static analysis? What do you understand by static analysis?
Yeah, actually, it's predefined checks will be performed against.
Okay, predefined checks performed against the code. Okay. Anything else? Anyone want to add on?
It's automation.
Okay, automation. Okay. Can you find it? Another time? It's okay, so it's better.
Code-based.
I'm sorry, what?
I think analysis of the code base regarding to the best practices that are specified.
Okay. Analyzing the code base for best practices. Fair enough. Okay. So, very, very simple, you know, like not going too deep into this. Static analysis tools try to check for correctness. Basically, how they work is they look at the code base, like you said. I'm sorry, I don't know your name, so. I'm sorry, yeah. So they just look at the code as against, you know, tools that run the code, like phpUnit. It basically runs your code and then does things, right? This will not run your code. This will just look at your code and try to check for correctness. Which means many things, you know, like you said, automated tests, you know, like there's a whole scope, but it's out of scope over here. So let's go back to the complexity. And like we're talking about maintainability again and again, you know, complexity measurement tools are really for the maintainability aspect. Some of the common tools, static analyzers, you know, you might know PHPStan and FAN. You might have heard of this tool called Drupal Check.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's based on PHPStan, right? For complexity, there are like few tools, you know, like PHP LOC and PHPMD are the main ones. PHP Defend is kind of like an I'm not really sure if it's maintained anymore. But these are the tools that give you some kind of metrics about your code, and we'll see them. This is what PHP LOC looks like. LOC is like lines of code, you know. So it basically looks like this. You know, it gives you like a whole summary that okay, this is an example I took it from internet. So, like some 2,000 lines of code, and how many of them are comments, and how many of them are logical lines of code, and all that gives you a measure. It also gives you like cyclomatic complexity, and like, I mean, your code base will have multiple methods, multiple classes, right? You know, so it gives you an average of all of that. You know, so it will also give you like, okay, which is the class with the minimum complexity, and what's the maximum that it can find? So like over here, we could see that 139 was maximum. And over here, maximum method complexity form was 96. Dependencies play a role, but again, we'll not talk a lot about dependencies. But there are other metrics, like, you know, Hastert's volume, Hastert's bug size, you know, like there are many other volumes, sorry, many other metrics then measure dependencies. Structure, again, you know, this tool gives you a lot of statistical information about your piece of code. Another tool which is quite popular is PHPMD, mesh detector. Anyone used either of these tools?
Mesh detector
you use. So, excuse me. So, it'll, you know, like PHPMD, the way it works is there are different rule sets. And, you know, here I'm using code size and naming. So, code size gives you those, the metrics we talked about, cyclomatic complexity and all that. So, it's telling me in this one particular module, in this particular method has cyclomatic complexity of 13. And you can configure it, like, you know, okay, the configured cyclomatic complexity is 10 in this case, the threshold. So, it's reporting 13, which means that every other method is like less than 10. Like, okay, I should just worry about this method and refactoring this method. These are some of the rules in PHP mesh detector. But in the, I already said, you know, code size rules, those are the rules that we discussed about. But there are a lot of other nice rules, you know, you can consider using it in your code. Just run it once and see if it works for you. Clean code rules and, you know, like these things. You know, we didn't talk a lot about dependencies, but like clean code will check, you know, if your class is dependent on too many other classes. That's another sign of, you know, like the code is not maintainable. Then, excuse me. Then you have tools that kind of, like you saw the output of this, right? It's a little difficult to report, you know, it's not that fancy. So then there are things like, you know, that give you this kind of output, like nice bar graphs and pie charts and everything. And if I have the opportunity, I'll try to walk you through a live thing. So let me get, like, you know, straight into the last part of this thing. How do you use these tools? Now, you can directly install each tool. If you go to PHPLOC, PHPMD page, you can follow the instructions, install it. Or, now, little bit of shameless plug over here because I maintain a Docker image which wraps up all of these tools for you to use. So it's, if you're into Docker at all, you know, like it's, the name is HuseinWeb/DrupalQA. And it's based on another image called, this name, I'm not really sure how to pronounce that, HNGKZA/PHPQA. And that already contains a lot of tools for PHP ecosystem. All I do is add tools. Okay, so it supports these three PHP versions. So you can like have different images for each of these PHP versions. All I do is add things like peer review. You might have used that Drupal coder snaps, like, you know, Drupal secure, Drupal practice, and Drupal check. You know, we just talked about it. It contains all of that. And of course, it contains all the tools from the base image. So like things like PHPMD, PHPLog. There is a whole list. I think there are about like 20 tools in there. So using it is quite simple. You know, you just run docker pull HuseinWeb/DrupalQA:latest, which is PHP 7.3. You can also do like 7.2 or something, you know, like PHP 7.2 or 7.1 to get that version. And when you want to actually use it, you'd use a command like this, docker run. Okay, I should ask this maybe. How many of you have used Docker in some way? Okay, so I guess about half of the room. So for like the other half of the room, you know, like very quickly, just bear with me. Very quickly, I'm just, you know, I'm running this image in a container, and I'm saying that it should work as a terminal. And I'm mounting my current directory over here to the slash project, you know, so that my current code base, I can access it from inside my container. And this is, by the way, you know, if you search for HuseinWeb/DrupalQA, all these instructions are there online. So, and finally, you mentioned the image name, HuseinWeb/DrupalQA, or DrupalQA:PHP 7.2, whatever it is, specific one, and give the command you want to run. So like PHP style analyze the command. This last part is the command. It could be PHPMD or PHP style or PHPLOC, whatever. So why basically do this? How many of you practice continuous integration in your teams? A lot of you, right? So, in many of the CI tools that exist nowadays, you know, they're heavily adopting Docker and everything. And this image, that's the reason I wrote it basically, you know, because I wanted to use it in one CI pipeline. So that's the reason I wrote it. You know, this is how I use it in GitLab CI. We use GitLab at Accenture. So in one project, this is how we just use it. You know, I just mentioned the image name. And these are the scripts I want to run, PHP CS with Drupal. I'm running three different commands, you know, PHP CS, once each with two different standards, and last PHP MD. And you can run anything you want, so like this is basically how you run it in CI. So at this point, let me take questions first, and if there is time, I'll try to do that live demo. I don't think I have a lot of time left. How much time do I have left? 10 minutes? Okay, then fine. If there are any questions, I can take that first.
In the Drupal PA image, you have to identify the all the cyclomatic complexity and infra
complexities. So, your question was, will the Drupal QA image identify those metrics that we talked about? The answer is yes and no, because the Drupal QA is just including those tools. You would still use PHP MD, so it contains PHP MD. So what it means is that if you use the Docker image, you don't have to install those things on your machine.
It's a package.
It's a package, yeah. It's an image which contains all those tools. So it contains PHP MD, which will let you analyze that, which will give you all this information. Any other questions? Okay, I'm still happy to take questions, but let me just quickly set up the demo. How many of you are using this MacBook which has this keyboard issue? Okay. So very quickly, you know, this is very similar to the command I showed before, and I'm going to show that, you know, the dashboard which I output. So this is this. There is this thing called Conflict Tracker I have written. You know, we use it internally. It's open source, by the way. You can find it on. Everything before this is, you know, is what I showed before. You know, it's just like things that you need for the Docker to get running. And finally, I'm saying that, okay, run Hooksin Web Drupal QA. And for analyze, I basically need two commands. You know, first I need to run the analyze command itself, and then I need to generate the HTML out of it. Because for some reason, the serve didn't work directly. So that's why I'm running bash. I'm not running a command directly. I'm running bash with these two commands. So I'm analyzing the custom modules directly, and then I'm bundling it into a directory called report. I don't think this needs internet, so it should work fast. So you can see again that it didn't do a lot. I mean, it basically just called different tools for it. But now the magic is that, you know, all these tools that report these different metrics, it builds a nice HTML dashboard. Oh, by the way, I should point out that this tool is not really maintained. I mean, like last commit was like, I think, a year back. So, but it works, you know, like you can see it works, so feel free to use it. It should just take another few seconds. I'll get the browser. it's done. So it has generated the report directory now, you know, if I see that thing, you'll see there is a directory called report. That's what I had given, you know, in my parameter. So all I need to do is serve the report directory. I'm just going to do it with Docker again, because it has to run in the server. You can't directly open the HTML file. Yeah, I'm just going to do it with Nginx. Okay, I think it's done. Yeah, so that's what it looks like. You know, it gives you like a nice summary of everything. It found 3 violations from mesh detector, check style violations for 444. Be kind of me, this was like written by me like 3 years back, I think, 4 years back maybe. So let's look at the metrics. There are many other things you can check out, but like let's just jump to the metrics. Right? Yes, it. So it tells you all of these things. You can see like a lot of metrics over here, including the things that we talked about, you know, cyclomatic complexity and path complexity. CRAP as well, but it will not give you anything right now. It's all zero because coverage has not run. There's no coverage. So we'll just look at a few of the metrics over here. We'll look at cyclomatic complexity. If you remember, we saw this function was 12, right? Everything else is like less than 10, 6, and all that. Extend cyclomatic complexity. I think it just adds one for the function. N-path complexity. So again, the same method, you know, which you saw earlier, that has a very high N-path complexity also. Big surprise, you know, like 101. Again, not as bad as billion and all that, but like 101 is still quite bad. You know, something that we should look into. Now these are other metrics which we didn't talk about, but I'll quickly go through them. Maintainability index. You know, it again gives you a kind of index on how maintainable this piece of code is. So now this one is like highest maintainable, 78.28. And Halstead bugs, difficulty, all of these things. I said Halstead before, I'm sorry, it's Halstead. All of these metrics. By the way, you can like look it up online. These are all again, Halstead, I think he did this work in 70s or 80s, maybe if I'm remembering it correctly. So like, you know, when software engineering was still a mathematical science, you know, we don't think of software engineering as mathematics nowadays, but it very much is. So at that point of time, we did all this work. So like a lot of these things, you know, effort, all of these are, you just look it up. So I am back at questions if still someone has any. And that's, there is a summary. And always you can reach out to me at HuseinWeb. So any questions? I think we are almost at the end.
Yeah.
So we are out of time. Okay, so we are on time, which is a good sign, which means if you have any questions, please find me later, and if you can't find me, Twitter. Thank you everyone, thank you for being a great audience. Bye.